In this video, we will discuss on development of interventricular septum. First, we will discuss on heart tubes and cardiac looping for better understanding. By the third week of embryo development, the two endothelial tubes fuses to form a single heart tube. It has arterial end and venous end. The arterial end is called truncus arteriosus and the venous end is called sinus venosus. Between them are bulbous cordis, primitive ventricle and primitive atrium. Bulbous cordis can be divided into three parts: proximal one-third, middle one-third and the distal one-third. The proximal one-third of bulbous cordis fuses with the primitive ventricle to form bulboventricular chamber. The sulcus between the primitive ventricle and the bulbous cordis is called bulboventricular sulcus. The proximal one-third later forms the trabeculated part of right ventricle, and the remaining primitive ventricle forms the trabeculated part of left ventricle. Middle third of bulbous cordis is called conus cordis. It forms the smooth outflow parts of both the ventricles. Distal one-third of bulbous cordis is called truncus arteriosus. During development, the bulboventricular part grows faster, and as the ends of the heart tubes are fixed to the surrounding tissue outside the pericardial cavity, that is, the arterial end is fixed to the branchial arches and the venous end to the septum transversum. Elongation cannot take place in a longitudinal direction, so the heart tube bends on itself ventrally, caudally, and slightly towards the right side. This forms the U-shaped bulboventricular loop. The cardiac loop thus has an ascending limb that is formed by the bulbous cordis and a descending limb formed by the primitive ventricle. The primitive atrium and sinus venosus get freed from the septum transversum. They move upwards and lie behind the bulbous cordis, truncus arteriosus, and bulboventricular chamber. On expansion, the primitive atrium projects forwards on either side of truncus arteriosus as auricles. Now let's discuss the development of interventricular septum. Interventricular septum separates the right ventricle from the left ventricle. It consists of three parts, namely muscular, bulbar, and membranous. The muscular part of interventricular septum grows from the floor of bulboventricular cavity and divides the lower part of the ventricle into right and left halves. On external surface of the heart, the site of formation of interventricular septum corresponds to the bulboventricular sulcus. The upper margin of the muscular septum is free. The gap above it is called interventricular foramen. The interventricular foramen allows communication between the two ventricles. Two bulbar swellings develops along the right dorsal and left ventral walls of the conus cordis. These swellings grow towards each other and fuse to form the bulbar or conal septum. It divides the conus cordis into anterolateral portion and posteromedial portion. The anterolateral portion forms the right ventricular outflow tract, and the posteromedial portion forms the left ventricular outflow tract. It should be noted that the distal part of the bulbar septum fuses with the aorticopulmonary septum, which divides the truncus arteriosus into aorta and pulmonary artery. After the formation of the bulbar septum, the interventricular foramen shrinks. The remaining gap of the interventricular foramen is filled by proliferation of tissues of the atrioventricular cushions. This part of the septum is called membranous part of the interventricular septum. It should be noted that the anterior part of the membranous septum separates the right and left ventricles. The posterior part of the membranous septum separates the left ventricle from the right atrium. This completes the development of interventricular septum. The abnormality in the development of interventricular septum leads to the formation of ventricular septal defect or VSD. It can be classified anatomically according to the part of the interventricular septum involved. If there is a defect in the membranous part of the septum, it is called membranous VSD. If the membranous VSD extends into the adjacent muscular part, it is called perimembranous VSD. The muscular part is divided into inlet, trabecular and infundibular components. The infundibular component is formed by the bulbar or coronal septum, as discussed earlier. If the inlet component is involved, it is called inlet VSD. A defect in trabecular part of the muscular septum is called muscular VSD. It can be either posterior, anterior, bimuscular or apical. A defect in the coronal septum is called infundibular or outlet or coronal or subpulmonary or doubly committed subarterial VSD. We complete the video here. Thanks for watching. Hope it was useful. See you soon in the next video.